Chapter 6. Suppressing my occasional fears of what might lie before me, I pressed on. I felt that something special was waiting for me in Nepal. From Patna, I traveled by train to Raxal, a town near the border between India and Nepal. A truck driver, his hair and clothes soiled by the dusty roads, smiled through teeth stained red from chewing spices. With a wave of his hand, he welcomed me to climb onto the cargo trailer. I found a place among the other passengers, mountain women, dressed in long faded dresses with scarves wrapped over their gray hair, and farmers in faded cloth, traveling with their bleating goats and cackling chickens, and sat atop one of the many burlap grain bags piled up under our feet. We jostled along, ascending ever higher up the bumpy road. The cargo area had no roof and was overloaded as much as humanly possible, so much so that we rode higher than the truck's cab. Although the conveyance was neither comfortable nor safe, there could be no better panoramic view of the Himalayas. As we climbed to greater elevations, verdant mountains and valleys stretched in all directions. Snow-clad peaks presided over the horizons and at times soared above us. My lungs feasted on the fresh mountain air and my flesh thrilled to the touch of the crisp breeze. No one seemed to mind being lashed periodically by monsoon storms. Hours later, in the middle of the night, the truck dropped us off just outside of Kathmandu. Exhausted and hungry, I continued on my way alone through the damp, black night. Dilapidated wooden houses loomed on either side of the deserted street. But something else seized my attention. From a distance, I could hear the mad howling of dogs. With growing apprehension, I began to recollect warnings I'd been given from wandering sadhus about the wild dogs. How by night they roamed in crazed packs. How the pack would ensnare their prey in an ever-tightening circle, ferociously attack and rip their victim limb from limb. How they would then devour the corpse on the spot. Almost as soon as I'd had that thought, an outcast dog, foaming at the mouth, spotted me alone on the deserted street. He flung his head back and pierced the sky with a howl. Seconds later, a pack of snarling dogs charged toward me. Were there six or eight? I was too shaken to count, but I did grasp the significance of the foamy white venom dripping from their snapping mouths. These beasts were rabid. Eyes bulging with rage, they closed in on me, howling madly all the while, intending to tear me apart. Their scrawny bodies were gaunt and nearly hairless. Their unearthly din petrified me. With foaming mouths and fangs dripping venom, they pressed in on me. To prevent an attack from behind, I pressed my back against a house, and in the darkness I prayed, "What shall I do?" Then, as if shaken from a trance, I remembered the walking stick that Ram Sevak Swami had given me. Wildly, I began to swing it back and forth. The horde fell back into a semicircle around me, only a few feet away. As each frenzied dog lunged forward, I whacked its snout with the Swami's stick. With the full force of my skinny arms, I struck. Growling ferociously, yet another predator leapt at me. I whacked him as hard as I could. Each of my attackers, when being beaten back by the stick, would fall back only momentarily, and then, unfazed, leap to attack again. Howls filled the night. Again and again, the pack surged toward me, and again, I managed to smack them down. But the more I fought, the more they escalated the siege. They could smell my flesh and blood. They could sense my exhaustion. There was no time to think. Every second, I had to swing that stick with all my might. If even one dog were to get through, the horde would descend and instantly devour me. Was this to be my fate? To end as dog food? My strength was waning. Sensing imminent victory, their snarling became more fierce and deafening. They closed in for the kill, so tightly now I nearly blacked out from the stench of their breath. Feverish, despairing, I helplessly prayed for mercy. I felt utterly alone and on the verge of being killed. Just then, glancing over my shoulder, I noticed a closed door behind me. Was it locked? A single ray of hope broke through my nightmare. I quickly swung my shoulder around, twisted the knob, and pushed. The door gave way. I dove inside and slammed it shut behind me. Outside, the dogs vented their indignation by hurling their bodies against the door. Inside, it was pitch dark. Suddenly, a lantern flared up, revealing a family together on the floor, roused from their sleep. The men of the house, thinking me to be a burglar, sprang to their feet, demanding to know who I was. But I couldn't speak their language. Lifting a sword, a man charged toward me. What could I do but sink to my knees and with joined palms beg for mercy? When the host saw my supplications, he softened, and with arms stretched, pointed his finger to the door, demanding that I leave at once. But hearing the ferocious screams of the dogs, he paused and understood that for me to go outside would mean death. Still, he was apprehensive about this late-night intruder, and he stared long and hard into my eyes as if groping to size up my character and intentions. With only my expression, I pleaded for him to give me shelter. Somehow, my silent plea reached him. He placed down his sword and offered me a seat. From this moment, he began to see me in a new light, accepting me as a sadhu who had come under extraordinary circumstances to bless his home. The other residents followed his lead and prepared for me fruit and hot sweetened milk, which I gratefully accepted. I spent the rest of the night as their guest, listening to the pack of hungry dogs barking outside the door until dawn, their fury unabated. I had once heard an old analogy from the American Indians, and it came to my mind now. Within every heart dwell two dogs, a bad dog and a good dog, both at battle with one another. The bad dog represents our debased tendencies of envy, anger, lust, greed, arrogance, and illusion. The good dog, our divine nature, is represented by forgiveness, compassion, self-control, generosity, humility, and wisdom. Whichever dog we feed the most through the choices we make and the utilization of our time will empower that dog to bark the loudest and conquer the other. Virtue is to starve the bad dog and feed the good dog. the pack of bad dogs that attacked me tonight, foaming at the mouth with the lust to devour me, was a graphic visualization of what I was up against in my internal journey. As I lay there in relief, my thoughts flowed gratefully to Ram Sevak Swami. If he had not given me that stick, I would surely have died tonight. I recalled his words, prophetic and true. The stick of a devotee's mercy can save one from the greatest dangers. The next morning, when quiet prevailed and the dogs scattered for the day, I thanked my hosts profusely and left to visit a temple of Lord Vishnu. Here I heard a group of sadhus praising Janakpur, a holy place in the plains of Nepal where Sita, the consort of Lord Rama, appeared on earth. Their words invoked my spirit of adventure, and at once I departed. From Kathmandu, I found passage on a rickety bus destined for Janakpur. Hours passed. The bus descended the Himalayan mountains and crossed the plains into a dense jungle where I saw a wild rhinoceros grazing on the foliage. Arriving in Janakpur, I first visited Bihar Kun, a small lake in an open, quiet area surrounded by old trees, quaint shrines, and an ashram where I was brought before the guru, Sri Vaidji. He was an aged sadhu with white stubble covering his jaw and head. He was overwhelmingly kind and begged me to reside in his ashram with free meals of rice and dal each day. Sri Vaidji explained to me why Janakpur was a holy place. Known in the scriptures as Mithila, its glory sung in the spiritual epic Ramayana. King Janak, in preparation for a religious site, was plowing the soil here when out from the earth, the goddess Sita appeared right under his plow. She became known as Janaki, the daughter of King Janak. Mithila was the first meeting place of Sita and Rama, and the place where Rama broke the mighty bow of Shiva to win the hand of Sita in marriage. By this time in my travels, the stories of God's incarnations on earth had become completely real to me. Seeing how enthralled I was, the kind Sri Vaidji presented me with English translations of two Indian classics, the Ramayana by Valmiki and Ram Charitamanas by Tulsidas. They were thick volumes, and every morning I rose, bathed in a nearby lake, performed my meditation, and began my study, reading from sunrise until sunset. I found the Ramayana packed with adventure, romance, tragedy, heroism, horror, humor, and war. But there was more to it than this. All these elements harmonized in a spirit of devotion to awaken the love of God in the heart of the reader. When I volunteered to do some chores, Sri Vaidji just smiled and said, "Your reading and accepting our food is purifying my heart. What greater service can I ask for?" On an early afternoon, I sat on the main road, a dusty path, and did not see a single car or truck pass all day. This was not surprising, since giant Nepalese elephants were the common form of transport in Janakpur. On the back of each elephant a large cargo box was secured by a rope extending around its belly. The driver, typically a small boy, sat on the elephant's neck, just behind the head, and held a stick. A heavy brass bell hung from the elephant's neck, clanging as it swung from side to side. Each elephant moved with a regal, confident gait. Elephant after elephant passed in this way, along with oxen and water buffalo pulling overloaded carts. Women strolled past carrying either baskets or earthen pots on the top of their heads, often balancing the load without their hands. Even small girls effortlessly carried big loads in this way, maintaining perfect posture. As these girls carried their loads, they blissfully sang together the glories of Sita and Rama. The peaceful life these people lived soothed my heart. I prayed that Janakpur would never change. Near a sacred lake in the heart of Janakpur sat many temples. Two of these temples were prominent, Janaki Mandir and Rama Mandir. One day in the court of Ram Mandir, I came upon a sadhu in his 50s, sitting on a raised platform beside the temple, with his long matted hair, beard, and mendicant's robes. He appeared peaceful and holy. Hundreds of people stood in line to receive his blessings. When they reached the front, he graciously blessed them with his open palm. Desiring his holy blessing, I too joined the line and approached him, bowing down like all the others. Surprised to see me, he motioned for me to sit beside him on the platform. I felt especially privileged. While continuing to bless one admirer after the next, he inquired of me,
"Where do you come from?"
"America."
"Why have you come from your rich country to the poverty of India?"
"In search of God." He smiled at an old woman who lowered her head beneath his beneficent hand.
"Why have you become a sadhu?" he asked through his smile.
"To seek enlightenment," I said. Hearing my words, his expression grew sour. His smile melted into a frown and his voice became ugly. Shocked by this reversal, I did not know what to expect.
"You are a fool," he hissed. "You are simply a fool. Do you hear me? A fool, an ignorant fool."
I knew that I was a fool. Perhaps he wished to enlighten me. I inquired submissively, "Your Holiness, please instruct me how I can improve."
Flying into a tantrum, he screamed, "I have been living as a sadhu for 30 years. Do you know what I have attained? Nothing. In all my years as a sadhu, all I've gotten is some rotten rice and dal."
A woman stretched forth an infant to receive his blessing.
"America is a land of riches,"
he shouted at me while blessing the child with his palm.
"America has the most beautiful women to enjoy. America has big, comfortable houses and automobiles. America has fine clothes, food, and drink. America has the best movies and television."
He closed his eyes and sighed.
Oh, how I long for the pleasures of America."
His eyes blazed now upon me.
"But you have given it all up, and for what? Rice and dal. I'm sick of rice and dal. You have come to this miserable place of poverty to search for God? You are a fool. There is no God. Do you hear me? There is no God. Go back to your great land to enjoy. If you don't obey me, you will lead a despicable life and be cursed with the misery."
As he spewed forth these words, hundreds of his admirers were busily worshiping him. They did not understand a word of English. The whole while he chastised me, his open palm was blessing these innocent, God-fearing people. They were begging him for God's blessings while he was decrying God's existence. They honored him as an enlightened being while he was speaking of the miserable futility of his life. In a daze, I walked away. My mind struggled to understand what the Lord had just revealed to me. The man was right. America was a land of riches and comforts. But I had lost my interest in a merely comfortable life. Instead, I felt I was traveling a road that was at times easy and beautiful, at times hard, but all in search of a greater treasure than anything the material world had to offer. If this man wanted to enjoy material life, why didn't he get a job and be honest? Instead, he posed as a saint to cheat the innocent. There is always the real and the counterfeit. Hypocrisy in religion has crippled people's faith throughout history. A holy person cannot always be recognized by external appearance. The Bhagavad-gita teaches that renunciation is not for a lazy man who does no work, but for one who works in a spirit of devotion. I thought of all the people I had been meeting who lived their lives working in the spirit of devotion, and I prayed that I could be one of them. I remembered the words I had heard Srila Prabhupada speak in Bombay. Better to be a sincere sweeper of the street than a charlatan meditator. Then I thought about that poor man pretending to be a sadhu. His bad dog is barking loudly, and he's daily feeding it enormous portions of rice and dal.